What's up, everybody out there in 420 land? This is the co-host of Two Stone Dudes Podcast, Ryan Castle. The Anchor app is where I got my start, and it's been amazing being a podcast host so far because of Anchor. Let me explain. It's the easiest way to make a podcast for free. That's right, it's free. Anchor then distributes your podcast to Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and so many more. And I won't forget about the creation tools that allow you to edit your podcast from your phone or your PC. And you can get paid with no minimum listenership. It's everything you need to make your very own podcast. Download the free app or go to anchor.fm.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another episode of Two Stone Dudes Podcast. This is your co-host, Ryan Castle. Just want to say we had an awesome podcast so far. We had my man Chafe come on at the end and an awesome, awesome interview with the Alpha Male Buddhist from Brooklyn podcast, Miguel. It was just fucking awesome. I really can't wait for you guys to hear the interview and the session with my man Chafe. It was a great, great podcast, and I'm looking forward to hearing your guys' feedback from it. So check it out and look out for the link. Thank you for listening. Welcome to the next episode of the Two Stone Dudes Podcast. This is your co-host, Ryan Castle. Rob the Nod will be late for the show, ladies and gentlemen. I apologize for that right off the bat. Today, on the line, we have a special, special interview with another podcaster, the Alpha Male Buddhist from Brooklyn Podcast, host Miguel. Miguel or Mike, which do you prefer?
Miguel, on the podcast I go by Miguel, I kind of go by both, but, you know.
All right.
Miguel is more hip these days.
I guess so, man, I guess so.
There's
a question I wanted to ask that I didn't have on the format that I sent. It's, what got you into wanting to be a podcaster?
You give me some really good questions. Well, basically, for, I guess my whole life, since I was a really young kid, like 19 years old, since I can remember, I've always been a student of knowledge. And I've always been in a position of wanting to know why and how and how does this affect that and so forth, you know. And I guess after a while, after a few years, 20, 30, 20, I've accumulated quite a bit of knowledge, which is kind of integrating different topics into like one cohesive way of thinking and conducting my life. So I guess I found myself, I'll give you a quick example. I was a bike messenger when I was like 19 years old, working in Midtown Manhattan. Like, you know, like you see in the movies and all that, the bike messenger with the bag and shit.
Yeah.
So in Manhattan. And I'm in this building, and this brother walks on, black dude, that's also a messenger, but he's fuming. And I'm like, yo, what happened? And he was quiet. I says, let me guess, it was the receptionist on the 47th floor was a bitch. So he goes, yeah, man, and this is what I said to him. I said, don't you realize that by allowing her to put you in this state and having this kind of negative effect on you, she has control over you? It's like you walk up to her with a panel of buttons on your chest, and she pushed the anger button, and you reacted to her request, and you became angry. And he looked at me. And I kept on. By the time we got to the lobby, he looked at me. His face was refreshed, and it looked like he got hit by a bookcase of knowledge.
Nice.
He looked at me, and he was like, damn, he shook his head. And I saw him a few times after that, and we gave each other the nod. But I said to myself, you know, we need more of that in this world. So
yeah.
As a result, I was always giving out good advice, so whatever the type of advice is, trying to put things into perspective. So I guess almost two years ago, I said, let me put on a podcast. And it's funny, but a lot of the feedback that I get, you can read my comments online, you know, just type in, you know, from those comments, whatever, and iTunes, I guess iTunes is the only one that allows that, but I get such tremendous feedback that I can't put it into words. I think I get more out of reading that feedback from the people who are listening to me. So to answer your question, what started me podcasting was I want to share like what I've accumulated over my years. I want to share that with people so that it can benefit everything. It's like Bob Marley said, when the rain falls, it doesn't just fall on one tree, it falls on everywhere.
Right, right, yep. Man, I love your podcast. I apologize for not being able to listen to the last one.
It's cool, nobody.
And I stumbled across it.
How did you find it exactly?
Okay, so I was trying. I didn't know what Joe Rogan's podcast was called, so I went looking for it. And you had made a comment on one of the clips that was there, or you had a clip of it on your podcast of something that he was talking about. It was really motivational. I'm like, where did I get this from? And then I looked down and I saw the name of the podcast. I was like, all right, well, let me check this guy out. And you just have like just one branch on a tree of knowledge after another. And it was like, man, I really got into you. And when I came up with the idea to have other podcasters on our show, you're the first one I thought about. Like, it just made sense to do that. You know what I mean? Because I think you have such a broad message that I can get across such a broad spectrum of people that I had to have you on there, even if it's just to talk to a bunch of stoners that listen to this. You know what I mean?
My favorite shit is stoner talk, you know? Nice.
Yeah. Yeah, man. Oh, and Rob is in the studio.
Yo.
All right, Rob, we got a fellow New Yorker on the line.
Not in the house. Oh, yeah?
Yes, sir.
Oh.
Here's your mic.
A fellow New Yorker. Okay.
How's it going, Rob?
It's going good, man. I shit it correctly, supposedly, today. So, yeah, it's good news.
Yeah, man. Rob's a great coworker and a really good friend. He had my back on a bunch of shit today.
What you munching on, man?
Oh, granola bar.
Granola bar. No, you go ahead.
All right. I got the munchies. Yeah, I do. I apologize.
I was smoking my snack on the way.
Okay. So, let's get in these questions real quick. Okay, get to know you. Where are you originally from as opposed to where you live now?
Okay. So, I was born and raised in downtown Brooklyn. If you know the Barclays Center downtown?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay, well, the Barclays Center, that big plaque where he was birthday. Basically, Gowanus Projects, Michael Gwynn Projects over there in downtown Brooklyn. And I left there when I was 30 years old, except for a little interlude that I lived in Boston, Massachusetts for like 3 years, from like age, you know, 11 to 14 or something like that. I lived in Boston with my sister. So, Boston. Then from there, age 30, and I grew up in the hood, like really, really all fucked up shit. But I wouldn't trade it for anything. My wife and I, we bought a house out in Jersey, and I've been here ever since.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Since 1980, I guess? 90? Yeah. Or 1990.
He went across.
Oh, he went across. Yeah, man. Went to my state. Right on. Right on.
That's right. You're a Jersey kid, right?
Yes, sir. So where else have your travels taken you besides Boston? Any place else?
Oh, man, I've been traveling. When I was 22 years old, I was, again, doing that bike messenger stuff and working in mail rooms and shit. I had a desire to just travel and see the world, just whatever, from all the readings that I've done, and because I started really reading philosophy and shit, like the Tao Te Ching and everything, I was like 15, so I wanted to see the world, so I scraped together, man, and I was living with my mom at the time, I scraped together like $4,000, and I went to the Philippines, I went to Asia.
Oh, wow.
And I spent about 4 months there, and eventually met my wife there and all that. And that was the first time that I got to travel a little bit. And then subsequent to that, I guess, when I first got married, we went to Cancun, Mexico, and San Francisco, a few domestic places, not too much here, but about, I recently got my house paid off maybe 5 years ago. So as soon as we did that, we just started traveling. So I went, the first place we went to, destination was Barcelona, Spain.
Oh, wow.
And yeah, then we did Rome, Italy, of course. Then we did Paris, France. Well, I don't
want to
brag, man.
You're
asking me something.
No, man, this is what I'm looking for.
I could picture it.
Cinque Terre, I don't know if you know what that is, but it's the Italian Riviera.
Okay.
Right near Florence. And where else? I did Amalfi Coast, which is freaking amazing, man. The Amalfi Coast in Italy, south of Rome. Island of Capri. And I may have forgotten a couple of other spots, but I have a real passion for, like, Europe. You know, like, especially like Spain and Italy. But I have to admit it, the most beautiful city I've ever seen is Paris, France, dude.
Wow. Nice.
Shit.
It's completely different from out here.
I speak a little French, so it was cool.
Oh, sweet. Like, yeah, are you a little bit of, or are you fluent in it?
Je parle un peu de français, je oublie beaucoup de mots, il n'y a pas encore pratiquement français, mais j'oublie, mais jamais tout
That sounds fluid.
I can defend myself like maybe a little Italian, you know.
Okay.
A little bit here and there.
Damn.
Nice.
I told you it's going to be a good podcast.
Yeah.
I'm one of those dudes, man. You know, just to interject real quick, and I know that one of the questions is about, you know, smoking weed and shit. I started when I was like, I'm jumping to that point, being that we're in that state, right?
Mm-hmm.
I don't really do it now, you know, whatever, but when I was like 13, I started. And the thing with me was that I would go up and shit, and I'd start, like, going through the encyclopedia. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, wow.
Yeah, man. And then another thing I would do on Saturday mornings and Sunday mornings, I'll back up the truck a little bit. I was doing some kind of menial shit job, and I heard these two men talking. They happened to be two attorneys, and I'm listening to them. And I look at my point, and I'm like, yo, these guys are speaking a different language, man. And I mean, literally. And he's like, oh, whatever. I'm like, no, no, listen to these guys. And he's like, oh, we went in, and there was a circus over there. I'm like, this guy's waiting. Spacey was to a circus and his metaphor, and I'm like, dude. So what I ended up doing was on Saturday and Sunday morning, I would watch these political TV shows like Meet the Press and Face the Nation with my puppy, and I'd start with two people listening to them speak.
Huh.
Right? And I said to myself, dude, if I could talk like them, I'm getting out of the hood. You know what I'm saying?
Right, right.
And I ended up that, and I do that, and, you know, get zooted, and I start reading, like, you know, Down the Chain or the Book of Five Rings, you know, wow. A lot of different little books I would like. And this is before the internet, you know.
Hang up the phone.
That's AOL. That's AOL with 201 modem. Yeah. I'll tell you one other book that blew me away and kind of put me in the state that I'm in. I know we're all over the place, but that's me.
You're good, man.
You're good. But, you know, I'm still curious on where you were just standing around hearing two prosecutors talk. Was it in front of the train station?
It was a mill where my boy was working at.
Ah, okay. Like Midtown?
Midtown, Manhattan. Where are you from originally in the city?
Queens.
Cool. What part of Queens?
Forest Hills.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, but I was born and raised in Spanish Harlem, right down on 102nd Street.
East side, lower, yeah. Yeah. Upper east side, 162nd yeah. Street.
Handball Kingdom.
Yeah.
Great, I got two
more. A lot of Puerto Ricans.
Oh, yeah. Shit, that's why I was made.
Not Dominicans, too. But they got more Washington Heights.
Yeah, but you know what? As long as the stores are open, we're good.
Yeah, for sure. So, I was on Atlantic Avenue downtown, and I'm walking by there, and I love old bookstores, man. I was walking by this old bookstore.
They're rare.
And there were dollar books on the table, and there was a book on there by Carlos Castaneda called A Separate Reality.
Oh, yeah, tell me about that.
And he was walking, and he had like an illuminated head, and he was off the ground, and I'm like, yo, I'm buying this book. Nice. I'm buying this book. Dude, that book just completely, that whole book was one huge epiphany. It just changed the way I saw the world.
How so?
I don't know if you've ever read any Castaneda.
No, but I've heard a lot about it. I think you've told me more about it than I've ever heard of.
Oh, man, yeah. And what it did was, at the time that I read it, and the way it hit me, because at that time I had already started reading the Tao and the Dharmapada and a couple of things like that, this was a Native American Indian kind of approach to that, you know?
Okay.
And it kind of integrated a lot with things. My mom, in Puerto Rican, we have a thing that's called refrán. It's like phrases. So they don't make a lot of sense in English, but they make sense in Spanish.
Right.
Dime con tu camina y yo te digo quien tu eres. Like, show me who you walk with and I'll show you who you are. Little things like that. So that book, Separate Reality, I kind of saw a lot of, like, a little bit of my mom's old ways of, you know, the old ways, man, the old Spanish ways or the old Native American ways, because my grandma's, like, pretty much 100% Taino Indian.
They still work to this day.
Anyway, I'm
blabbering
enough. I'll listen to your questions and shit.
Yeah, he's the New Yorker, yeah.
Dude, trust me, I fully expected it. Don't worry about it.
Where's the off button?
I, my best friend's a New Yorker. I get it, man, all right?
Slow it down. Slow it down.
Oh, jeez. All right, man. What kind of kid were you growing up?
I was pretty much average. I like to play. I wasn't a bully. I wasn't a tough guy, anything like that. But if I had a Duke, I would Duke, you know. And I was an average kid, but I was always very, very inquisitive, and I wanted to know, like, the shit that was going on. And especially with regard to people that were doing shit.
Nice.
That was successful, you know, something. Like, how did he get there? Like, how did you know, I lost my dad when I was six.
Oh, wow.
My dad when I was 6 years old. So, as a result of that, I didn't have that support system or those roots in the ground to, like, give me the nourishment that I needed as a young boy. And my mom was very sickly, you know. She had epilepsy, and she did the best she could with me. But, yeah, I ended up in a position where as a kid, I had to kind of, like, figure out a way that I was going to get the fuck out of the ghetto. Like, I told you, when I was 9 years old, I was shining shoes by the courthouses on Court Street.
Right.
When I was 10, I was stealing Sunday newspapers on Saturday night. I was stealing them and selling them in the projects.
Huh.
You know, that's when I was 10. These guys, when they see that shopping cart is full when you go in the projects, and they see it's pretty much empty, they know you got money.
Yeah.
Right.
So I had to handle that shit, you know.
Shit.
Hey, I was lucky enough to work dogs for money.
At a young age, yeah.
Wow.
You had to do papers.
So now you had a question about the bullying also.
I did. Do you believe that the anti-bullying thing is a step in the right direction, or do you think that it hinders the growth of a person?
It's the worst thing that ever happened, man, because if you don't teach a young boy, and I use that word loosely because it's a young boy, if you don't teach him how to stand up for himself, man, then he's kind of done, in a sense, because the way he's able to stand up for himself against another individual, okay, I'll put it to you this way. If you grow up in a position where you're afraid of authority or you're afraid a guy's going to smash you or whatever, that is always going to be lingering behind your mind. You're going to be afraid of your boss subconsciously.
Right.
Because you were afraid of a bully when you were a kid.
Right.
So the most critical thing is for everybody doesn't get a trophy, dude.
Right.
If you know what I mean? So, yeah, no, I think it's the worst thing that ever happened. I think that, especially in young boys, young men, they need to be subjected to facing their fears and dealing with things that are hard to do, challenges, bullying, and all that shit.
Pretty much initiations, right?
Yes. Yep.
Like, there hasn't, like, initiation went away a long time ago. Rites of passage went away a long time ago, and I think that's definitely hindered the growth of the American male.
Absolutely. That's one of the reasons why I started that's why it's called the Alpha Male Buddhist Podcast, because the fact that sometimes when you hear Buddhist, you'll hear a guy, today, I don't do that shit. And when you hear Alpha Male, you'll think of a guy, that's not me either, but I'm kind of like, you know, I kind of integrate those two elements to get that perfect yin and yang balance.
I was just going to say, that's a yin and yang balance right there, yeah. That's pretty awesome, man. What was your favorite subject in high school?
Easy. I love biology and I love science.
Nice.
With a smattering of history.
Right on. Have you ever been to court as a defendant?
Me?
Everybody hesitates. Everybody hesitates.
It's a good question. Me personally, no, but what happened was when, I must have been 9, 10 years old, we had beef with a family like upstairs, some Dominicans upstairs, and it got a little crazy where the father of that family was kind of trying to dominate us. So I don't know what his issue was, but my brother and I kind of went off on him, and I don't know if this was thrown, it was a long time ago, but something happened and we ended up in court. And I kind of remembered that, but it was no big deal. The judge says, you guys got to get along. And I barely remembered. I think I was 10.
Wow.
So to answer your question, I never really was. Thank God I wasn't a defendant.
No?
Because I never got caught.
Because I never got caught. Nice. All right, what's on your music playlist?
Oh, God. I am a real freaking reggaehead, like old dancehall, Bob Marley, Eka Mouse, Steel Pulse. I love reggae, love jazz, like bebop and Charlie Parker, Thelonious Monk, Wes Montgomery. I mean, I can go on and on, Chaco Pastorius. I listen to fucking flamenco music, you know?
What is that?
Which is that Spanish guitar?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it's passionate music.
You would notice it as like Carlos and Santana.
Well, now I get the connection between the character on Mike Tyson's Punch Out, Don Flamenco, and his music. And now I get it. After like 30 years, I get the connection now. No shit.
I don't know what is that reference? Mike Tyson?
Yeah, Mike Tyson's Punch-Out, the video game, the Nintendo video game. There's a character named Don Flamenco, and he comes out to, like, the Spanish dance music, and I didn't know what the correlation was. Now I know.
Yeah.
After 35 years.
Yeah, it's what they call Hispano Gypsy.
Okay.
Subculture.
All right, cool.
It's a hit to the heart.
See, I'm learning new shit every fucking day. How about that?
I love it.
What type of music would you consider your favorite?
I couldn't pin that down, but it depends on where my headspace is at. You know?
Mm-hmm.
It really depends on my headspace. I can get into B.B. King blues. I can get into, like, just like, you pretty much, you name a genre. The only thing that I don't rock with too much is country music, but I freaking love Johnny Cash.
Oh, cool.
That makes sense.
That's why we're friends. All right.
Yeah, Johnny Cash is the man, bro. And I saw him in person one time at Central Park South.
Get out of here, really?
Yeah, I was walking down Central Park South, and I stopped across 59th Street, and I saw this dude in August dressed in all black with a hat, big dude. And I looked, and I'm like, fuck, that's Johnny Cash. And I looked at him, and I said, yo, you're Johnny Cash. He goes, yes, I am. By himself, and this guy was famous.
Wow.
Yeah,
jeez, man. Nice. That's pretty awesome. So you just got a new job, man. Without naming the company, what do you do for work now?
It's the same industry that I've been in. I do consulting / working in the staffing industry. So I do a little sales. I do recruiting. I do work with workers' comp and injuries and all that kind of stuff like that.
Okay. Well, congratulations on a new job, man. That's awesome.
Yeah, you know, I got hit by that COVID, man, in March, mid-March.
Yeah.
And everything crashed down, man. And the way it was put to me, I'm not going to get too detailed, but they were like, you know, we're going to put you, because I was earning pretty good, you know, and it's hard for them to support that salary, so this is, we're going to put you on unemployment, and then you're going to work off the books, or, you know, whatever. I'm like, no, you put me in unemployment, I'm on the job market.
Right.
So I did that, and I rode that train for $200 a week, I ain't stupid.
Right. you just needed some Vicks and sofrito, that's all you needed.
Ah, ya tú sabes.
I know.
Great, I got no idea what the fuck you guys are talking about, but it sounds yummy.
The food, man. Yeah.
It sounds delicious. Okay. I figured, see, I thought it was some kind of food.
Oh, yeah.
What's your end goal as a career?
What do you mean, my end goal?
Your end goal.
Oh, my end goal.
Yeah.
I don't have one, and I'll explain.
Okay.
We're spent, and it's funny, because this is on the Superior Man podcast. The first thing that he comes out with, and that's why this dude fucking blew me away, is that people, and this is not directly addressing what's my end goal, but it kind of is. People live an existence where they're waiting for this moment to come in their life when that's it. Like, I'm working towards this, I'm climbing this mountain, and then I get to the summit. And that day never comes. Or, if you're very observant, it's around you pretty much every moment, but you're not realizing. So, for me to have an end goal, and to, well, one of my main goals really was to travel. I mean, I did that. But my end goal is the end goal that I have in front of me right now doing this podcast, right? And then tomorrow is going to be the next task that I take. If it's going to be picking up my dog shit from the park, whatever it is, I try to find fulfillment in every freaking thing that I do. So my end goal is to really do a good job on this interview.
Nice.
I don't know if that makes sense.
Yeah, absolutely, man. You're fucking knocking it out the park so far, so goals achieved already. What's all right, let's get into my favorite part here, man. Politics and conspiracy theories.
Let's do it.
All right, so let's get your thoughts on a couple of subjects. First off, talk to me about COVID-19, its origins and reactions from the Western world of ideology.
If you listen back, I don't know, my episode just in March, like March 15th, I don't have the number in front of me. It's called Cure for the Coronavirus.
Right.
I just started blasting some old dance or reggae music.
Oh.
Yeah, I don't know if you heard, I said I went to the basement, I got my old grandma's record crate, and I started blasting some like fucking, you know, what's that guy, Tony? He's really famous now, Tony. I can't remember off the top of my head, but this COVID, honestly, we all know what the deal is with this, you know. It's...
Talk to us, tell us, brother.
It's some dark shit. They're trying to impose a one-world government on us, and the way to do it is to separate us, so we're 6 feet apart, to destroy 30 million businesses, or put 30 million people on unemployment, and so that we cannot integrate with one another, speak to one another. So you can't, you and I, you know, let's go to the park and play some ball. No, you don't have your mask. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, it's a control mechanism to the core, and there's an agenda behind it, and it's George Soros, socialist agenda. It's in all capital letters, a control mechanism they're trying to impose it on us, and to see how far they can push us. 9/11 was the first one. This is the phase two where they're trying to clamp that shit down on us, and it's the whole fucking planet.
Right.
It's not good, man.
Right. How many conspiracy theorists have you heard, like, say that this was going to happen? Because I've heard a lot of them say this was going to happen, like, 10 years ago and shit.
Of course. Have you ever heard of Bill Cooper?
No.
William Cooper.
Uh-uh.
Okay. He spoke about this shit 30 years ago.
Wow, really?
You know, well, 30 or 28 years ago, something like that, yeah. He's on YouTube, and verbatim, dude, like, he just spelled out, he predicted 9/11, like, months before it happened. He goes, you know, there's this guy, his name is Osama bin Laden, and this, something's going to happen, and they're going to blame it on him. So I swear to God.
Wow.
Him 9/11 and, happened this, about 30
this,
days later.
This guy in the Simpsons should join forces.
Yeah. All right.
And he was killed like shortly after that.
Oh shit! Get the fuck out of here.
He didn't see that coming.
Yeah. What? all right. Talk to me about the Black Lives Matter movement.
All right. Now there's two components to the Black Lives Matter. There's one component where Black Lives Matter. This guy, I forget his name again. That was murdered.
George Floyd.
I'm sorry.
George Floyd.
Yeah, George Floyd. He was murdered. Clear as day and everything like that. But that's one aspect of it. That movement was hijacked by George Soros and by the elites of the world, as we all know. You could call them Illuminati or whatever you want to call them, our quote-unquote controllers. They hijacked that movement because if you read their bylaws, now I don't know what your guys' political views are, but they're against the family. They're, you know, against everything that is God-fearing. And you know, Jesus is my anchor. You know, I'm off of course, but like, Jesus is my dude. You know, I'll just put it out there like that.
Okay.
And I say that very proudly. So the Black Lives Matter movement got hijacked, and here's the thing. They don't do shit for our community. You know, Puerto Rican and Black is basically the same thing.
Right.
The way it is.
Right.
It's just that way. But they ain't done shit for us, but to oppress us, because we're living much worse. Our community is living much worse today than we were back in the day. I said it in one of my podcasts. I remember being a kid, and there was this brother, black dude. He used to shine shoes, man. And he had a nice apartment, and he put two of his kids through college shining fucking shoes.
Oh, shit.
Try that. And of course, he hustled on the side and did stuff, but try that today, man. All that they do is negative because they have this, man, I should kind of bite my tongue a little bit, but they have this national privatized prison system in the one place. And just when, I don't know if you remember when rap music first started, when you had Boogie Down Productions with KRS-One,
right?
And you had there's another really good example, Don't Believe the Hype, what is it? Public Enemy,
yeah.
Some of that music was coming out really positive, man.
Yeah,
really uniting.
It made sense.
And all of a sudden it flipped into drugs and murder and what is that,
NWA.
And they ran all the gangster rap, and slowly but surely they started filling all the prisons for profit. Now these squatters were taken out of the home,
wow.
Everything like that. And it's done in such a powerful way that they indoctrinate our people in that they gladly are going to pick up that gun and start capping out fucking their own boys across the street. You know what? It's at a very fucking deep. It drives me nuts, man. Whatever happened to Public Enemy, to listen to the shit that they were talking. You know who gets into this? Have you heard of a group called the Brand Nubians?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, Lord Jamal. I don't know if you know him. 5%er.
Okay.
He breaks it down, man. He breaks it down about Soros and about the whole thing because they says, what do you think about the Black Lives Matter? He goes, that's not our movement. That movement was hijacked by Soros. And
wow.
That kind of like illuminated me to that shit, too. And if Lord Jamal is saying that's a smart dude, man. And he's got that supreme knowledge type shit. Which is not the knowledge you get, you know, in Harvard.
Right. Right. Damn. Talk to me about the presidential race between Trump and Biden.
I hate them both, man. But I don't want Biden. I just don't. But they're all the same.
Yes.
They're controlled by the same puppet strings.
Empty right. Promises.
Yeah, man.
Yeah. But what it does is a distraction to make it go just another day, just to make it go another month, just to make it go another year.
Oh, yeah.
You're back into that cycle where all they're doing is shoveling shit into your head, and people people soak it up. And then they fight against one another. They divide one another. That everything right now is division, man. It's division and there's no unity, man.
Right.
Look, man, all of this money that they're contributing, billions, these corporations, the Black Lives Matter, everything like that. Why don't you go in the freaking projects, man? Take like a little office, set it up, have the single parent moms come in with their kids and say, hey, man, does your kid have shoes? How is he doing in school? Maybe we should set up some kind of mentoring for him.
That means
maybe
they care.
Checking his freaking report card every time it comes out and hold him accountable for that report card that he has in his hand.
Yeah.
You know, like proactively get out there because I've seen him at FS. Dude, I can give you stories, man, of how I've seen people go to hell in a handbasket. You know? By the time this gangster rap hit, I was already like 30, and I was out of the hood at this point and everything like that, but I saw the
right
results
on time.
Of it, and all it did was fill these private prisons.
Wow.
Damn.
Oh, shit.
Hey, what happened when YMCA's actually did something?
Tell me about it. We used to have what's called the center.
Yeah.
And that was in Wyckoff Garden Projects, and it was a basketball court with a little pool table. And those dudes that worked there, they would come to you and say, yo, I haven't seen you in 2 weeks, man. Where you been? Or, I heard they saw you up in, you know, so-and-so. You know what I'm saying? And, you know, we kind of had accountability to them because they would give you a hard time.
Yeah.
You know, like, oh, you come in the center? And we called it the center. And, yeah, man, but you don't see that shit anymore. All you see right now is fucking chaos, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, dude. They were talking about it on Rogan's podcast how...
chaos in Walmart.
Like, it is normal to see riots and looting every day. When did that shit become normal?
When BLM got hijacked. When it got hijacked by the socialists, man. I mean, I don't know. You guys like into socialism, or I'm just curious.
No, man. I'm a libertarian. I don't think Rob's a Democrat.
Yeah,
I'm not sure.
Is very cool.
I'm someone who don't give a shit.
Yeah. All right.
It got hijacked, and that's when they started burning and destroying. You know that they were putting pallets of bricks next to, like, the Gucci store?
Yeah, dude, I heard about that.
Yeah.
It wasn't getting promoted, and it wasn't getting reported in the mainstream news either. You had to hear it from outside sources.
And YouTube, if you know how to search.
Yeah, and YouTube, yeah. Have you ever read 1984 or A Brave New World?
I read both. Orwell and Brave New World, Aldous Huxley?
Yes. Yes, that's both
the
authors.
You know, he was related to Sigmund Freud, and the other one, the marketing guy,
I was not aware
Edward
of that.
Bernays. Have you heard the name Edward Bernays?
Yes. Yes, I have.
They were related.
Wow.
1984, I saw the movie, I read the book. It's funny. When I went to Boston to live, and at 6th or 7th grade, I had this English teacher. She had us reading Beowulf, Brave New World, 1984.
Wow. That's some cool shit.
That was a good teacher.
Yeah, man. Yeah.
Nice.
She cared.
84 hit it on the head, man. It's exactly what you see right now.
I was going to say, real quick, would you, in your own words, explain to the audience what both of those books are about?
It's about world domination, and it's about subjugating humanity to become like in a cattle-like state where we're cattle, and we are just dictated on how to think, what to read. You know, to stand in front of that monitoring camera like in 1984, you know, where were you? And make sure you put back. And those things, and I'll tell you another one, The Matrix, because The Matrix is not a movie, it's a documentary.
Dude, oh man. You already answered one of my questions. I was going to ask you to subscribe to that theory. Shit.
I'm psychic, dude.
I'm telling you. That's, you know what? I kind of agree with you, dude. I totally believe that that this is not real.
It is, and it isn't in the sense of there are really actually people suffering right now.
Right.
And then you hear people talking about this law of attraction.
Right.
And a kid in India on the Ganges River or Benares, starving to death with his family, he can attract as much as he wants, and he ain't getting the rice, man.
Right.
You know? So that part, I'm sorry, but that punches holes in that. But there are elements of that law of attraction that are very, very true, because the first words, the name of the book is the Dharmapada, and this is Buddha's words. It's the actual book of Buddhism that are Buddha's actual words. All of the other books in Buddhism are people kind of addressing Buddhism, but the first words of the Dharmapada are, all that we are is what we think.
Right. That totally makes sense right there, doesn't it? That makes a lot of sense.
Right.
Okay, so obviously you believe in conspiracy theories. Do you have any of your own conspiracy theories?
Too many, and I'd be afraid to talk about half of them here, man, but... I've been into it forever, man. Yeah, you know, 9-11, and... okay, I'll put it to you real super simple. Have you heard of Building 7?
Yes.
Okay. Wasn't touched by anything and collapsed free full speed. That... will fill in any blanks you have.
Right, seriously. Like, that question hasn't been answered by mainstream at all.
Nope.
Oh, it probably never will be either.
No, it goes under the table.
Right. Do you believe that we're headed towards a socialist democracy that will usher in a totalitarian dictatorship?
That's the next stop on this train.
That's what I said. Yep.
Unless, especially young people like yourselves, man, wait the fuck up. Don't worry about getting $300 sneakers, dude. Get yourself a pair of $25 sneakers and a few books.
Message.
Yep.
Yep. That's what it is, man. We get young switchers. I ran with that ball quite a few times, man. But you know what? These legs are starting to get tired, and we need the young alpha men to stand the fuck up.
Yeah.
Realize what's taking place. Disseminate this information. Take a dominant alpha leadership role in society, and do it as they do it. In Africa or in Taino cultures or whatever like that, when you get a kid that's 16 or 17, 19 years old, he's got to go out on the hunt.
Yeah.
He's got to provide. He's got to do things. Not worry about his safe space or, you know, bubblegum fucking cotton candy ass fucking thinking. Yeah. No, man. You got to take that alpha. And even if you're not alpha, but put into the pot what you're able to contribute. You know, maybe right. It's supporting a dude that is trying to move men or trying to do this or trying to, you know, help some widows or orphans. Shit has to get done to help people, because the next stop is fucking these Agenda 21.
Right. Do you know what the Mandela effect is?
Vaguely, could you explain it to me?
Okay, so basically, sometime around, I believe it was 98, when the Super Collider was activated. After the debate, that it shouldn't be.
CERN, you mean the Super Collider in CERN?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, somehow or other, it either ripped a fabric.
Hold on, the fabric of the time.
Right, and people got.
I'm
totally in. So,
thanks,
what basically people think happened is that people crossed, like, dimensions and went into other dimensions that they weren't in before, and some people have memories that other people have tried to, address as just false memory, but how can, like, one half the population have a memory that another population didn't have? You know, it's. I'll give you a small example, okay? This is a Mandela effect for me. I was, I've already told this story like 3 times already, so I'm going to apologize to the audience, okay? So, I had this girl, I was working in Scottsdale, and this girl that I used to go to Narcotics Anonymous with, came, she saw me, she recognized me, I barely recognized her, and she, had a video of me at a party that I was at, that, number one, I don't ever remember being at. Two, it was a sober party, so there wasn't anything to mess up my memory of that party. Three, I had a Tampa Bay Buccaneers shirt, and I'm a hardcore Eagles fan, so I would never wear a Tampa Bay Buccaneers shirt to save my life.
And she showed you a picture?
No, she showed me a video.
Shit.
So, spooky. That was my little Mandela effect. Other people believe that Nelson Mandela... And I believe this as well, because I remember it, because it was shown to me when I was in grade school that Nelson Mandela died in prison. It was part...
Yes, I've heard that, and, like, real similar shit, like... Yeah, I mean, I've really heard about it, and to answer you, I would say absolutely, because time and space are just... What's the word way I'm thinking it? Time and space are just... the equivalent of a ruler to measure out a board. Well, time and space are the ways that we gauge our existence where we are, because we fall into that paradigm of time and space. We're not in the infinite. This is the finite. Number two, when you
Yeah.
When people flatline and they die in the hospital, they rise above the bed and then they see the time on the clock, the color of the, what do they call that? The scrubs that the nurse came in and how her brother was crying. Like, people see this shit.
Right.
And with the deja vu, when you say, yo, this guy's going to put down the Eight of Hearts and he's going to say, yo, get me a sandwich. Right? And then it happens.
Yeah.
I mean, you know. So, absolutely, yeah, exactly how and why and what and what. And I told you about my experience with the TV, so we ain't even get into that shit.
Right, right.
That's right. So, right. Absolutely, there's a lot of shit that we are totally, you know. One way that I'm going to put it, and I don't know if it addresses the Mandela effect or what you're saying, but, and I really strongly believe this, that God is experiencing creation subjectively through us. So he can actually feel our emotion because he gets bored. He's omnipotent. He's God. So what else? You know, I've done everything. So he, to entertain himself, experiences his creation subjectively through our existence, our lives. He's like, let me put this guy into some real hard pressure, and let me put this, and let me throw this, and the smattering of that. And he's like, you know what I mean? Like, he's bored, man.
Okay, so to put it in a universal setting, you believe that there is this other this other being out there that's omnipotent, that
supreme being
that experiences life through us as if we're little threads of that being itself.
Yeah, that's a very good way of putting it. Yeah, because he gets bored.
Right. Okay. I can understand that. Yeah.
He tweaks a few.
Yeah. So, do you know who David Icke and Alex Jones are?
Of course, David Icke. I've been listening to David Icke for years with the reptilian stuff and all that stuff.
Right.
And Alex Jones was from New Zealand.
You're not the first person to say that. Don't worry about it.
But I'll tell you one thing. He's a pioneer. He went to the Bohemian Grove with the mega piece and...
Yeah.
I got much love and much respect for Alex Jones.
Do you know the conspiracy theory around Alex Jones?
Tell me.
Okay, people think he's really Bill Hicks.
Right. It might be true.
Dude, he looks just like him, man. I don't know.
Exactly.
I don't know.
Like, they're both Texas guys.
Yeah, they're both from Texas. They both look a hell of a lot alike. And, and they had a lot of the same ideas, too.
Yes.
So...
Yes.
That's that kind of like that kind of puts that in perspective for people. You know what I mean?
That's like a
Yeah, dude. It's like, why don't you just say it and get it the fuck over with already? Stop trying to keep everybody in fucking suspense. God damn it.
And give me 40 minutes of stand-up.
Yes. Yeah. Come on, dude. Bust it out. I want to hear it. All right. So, do you think we've become a hedonistic society?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, for a reason.
Okay. Explain.
Now, you heard of Yuri Bezmenov, the Russian KGB agent?
That was on your show, yes.
Okay. If you recall, he said the three main things that they wanted to do is the first one is indoctrinate a kid from age...
like five, isn't it?
First grade, yeah. From first grade up into high school. And that takes 20 years because the educational system, by the time he graduates college, it's pretty close to 20 years or whatever have you. That's phase one, which they started doing, I think, in the early 70s. The next phase is the demoralization phase, right? Because if you're living in a space of being demoralized, you don't even really care about yourself because your mind is at the lowest chakra. You're at the base sex. Eat it, fuck it, or kill it.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
And that's what the demoralization does because it just shatters everything. What distinguishes us from animals is the fact that we have love, that we help one, even though some other animals do it, but we have that supreme spark of God within us, right? So the demoralization is to remove that so that we can be herded into the cattle pens. The third phase of that is the, I forget the exact word, but it's the taking over of all of the institutions, of the schools, of the governments, and all that kind of shit like that. So to answer your question, it's the hedonistic. Absolutely, man. I mean, if you had a daughter, would you want her, what do they call it, the twerking and all that shit?
No, absolutely not. Me and my daughter would have a long, long talk about some shit like that.
There'd be some talking, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
So, it's all planned out. And how can I explain? It's a very base pleasure. So, you over, with the pornography and all that stuff like that, you overload the senses with that. And what it does is it removes you from your divine, like, purpose and your divine state of being. I'm not saying if you watch porn or you smoke, none of that. I mean, this is a big world and there's a lot of options and choices in it. But a lot of people cannot handle it. They get overloaded with the stimulus, man. They can't handle it. And it basically, again, it's controlling their whole existence.
There's all different types of mind control.
Yep.
Shit.
Materialism, you know, wanting to get these sneakers, wanting to have, you know, this kind of car. Fuck millions, I want billions. The more you chase that, the less fulfilled you're going to be, because the only true fulfillment that you're going to get is from within yourself and your connection to the infinite.
Nice. I'm going to kill the mood on this one. Okay, sorry. Who killed Kennedy?
You want the real answer?
Yeah.
A lot of people, because...
A lot of people.
A lot of people.
It's true. There were two presidents that issued money through the government and not the Federal Reserve Bank, but they issued money through the Treasury. The first one was Abraham Lincoln.
Mm.
You go look this up. The second one was JFK.
Wow.
So the bankers were one, and just a whole bunch of people, because Kennedy really wanted to do good. And if you notice, early in this thing, he was really trying to help people in the ghetto and trying to help poor people and really actively trying to do shit. He had to go.
Yeah.
Wow.
Kind of like Hendrix. Look at Hendrix's music and what Jimi Hendrix did.
Oh, yeah.
He's 29 years old, man. And this girl from Pearl Jam or one of these groups.
Nirvana.
Yeah, man.
Anyone you can't control has to go.
You gotta get rid of these people, man.
See?
Yeah, man.
Anyone you can't control has to go.
Yeah.
And anybody don't try to do good.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good.
They'll limit it. They'll let you allow it just to a certain extent and then shut you down if you go too far.
Well, I figure we'll just keep speaking truth on this podcast till somebody waxes me. You know,
fucking blackmail, bitches.
Nah, it's too late because the cat's out of the bag now. Because, yo, there's dudes that is talking shit 15 levels above us.
Right.
You know, shit that we're talking about. Especially that pedophilia, man. Because, you know, Hillary's real name is Killer. You know that, right?
Yeah. Oh, that's funny, dude. That's funny.
If only the government can express themselves like some rappers do when they just snitch on themselves.
Oh, Jesus, yeah. All right, man. Was the moon landing faked?
Fake as shit.
Damn. Stand by that shit. Tell us about it, bro.
Well, they got photographs where they show shadows projecting out of two different angles.
Yeah.
Oh, no shit.
Yeah.
That right there, I looked at
it. I heard about that.
Oh, yeah, dude. I believed that shit up until about 5 years ago.
Then in the photos, they also said that the photos were fake as well, you know.
Which was fake?
That the real, well, the shadow wasn't a shadow. It was something from another image or something that was altered in the background.
Right. Yeah. Right. Yeah, there's a lot.
So much crap.
What's, all right, we're going to get to the miscellaneous part here. What's your favorite food?
Damn. I love fried chicken.
Nice. Who doesn't? Right? Shit.
Especially my mother's fried chicken, where she's
oh,
the
vegan. Yes.
Bro, you know that. I like everything. Man.
I'm a Popeye's head, bro. Love Popeyes.
It is the shiznit.
I love Popeyes, man. Damn it. Yo, check this out. I'm on like a little bit of a diet. I have a Taco Bell in walking distance of my place and I can't eat there. This is some bullshit.
What? You don't like cleansing or is it colon cleansing?
What's that?
Oh,
dude, you're killing me over here.
And I don't mind their breakfast. It's actually okay.
Yeah. All right, man. Gelato, frozen yogurt, or ice cream?
Shit, depends on what kind of ice cream or what kind of gelato, but I would go for some good ice cream, dude.
Nice. What kind?
It depends. It could be chocolate or butter pecan.
Butter pecan. That's such a butter pecan is an East Coast thing. I noticed, man. A lot of people from East Coast.
If it is, it's got to be on a cone. It's got to be on a cone.
You got like Häagen-Dazs makes like a vicious butter pecan.
Oh, nice.
They do.
All right, so if you can wave this magic wand and vote for anybody to be president, who would it be?
What's this girl's name?
Say Joe Jorgensen. No.
No. She's part of that Pray to You, young black woman. She's really starting to blow up.
Candace Owens. Okay, I haven't heard of her. Have you, Rob?
Yeah,
Candace Owens?
I have to say no. Maybe
no,
my
we
face.
Have not heard of it.
Okay. She's really good.
Okay. What does she do?
She speaks real shit, man. She talks about, as they're talking about, oh, we have the program and then 1,000 points of light. And she's like, no, we don't need 1,000 points of light. We need to get to these young kids right now that are 6 and 7 years old that are fatherless. You know, that she's on some real shit.
Nice.
But I don't, there's no leader out here that's going to do anything for us. That's why I kind of flipped. I found myself in some of my podcasts going really dark.
Okay.
As far as things that are going on, and I still do it on occasion, but I also say that you have to look within because, look, worst case scenario, I die, and I go to my maker, and he's going to tally up everything with me, and he's going to see my karma and everything like that, and then I'm going to ascend to my position as a result of this life that I've led. You believe in reincarnation?
Yeah.
Yeah. So there's only a limited. We have a saying. My mother would say there's a saying in Puerto Rico: "Si te matan del piso no pasa." Si te matan del piso no pasa. If they kill you, you can't go beneath the floor. Like you can only fall on the ground, and that's it. Like that's all they can do to you.
Right.
So if you take a very spiritual look at this, that I'm looking, and not that I'm giving up on this life, but the degree of control that you have over me as a man. Ends with me lying on the ground.
Nice.
It ends there, and then I move on. You know, it's Puerto Rican, it makes a lot more sense, but
it's making a lot. Dude, trust me, it makes enough sense. You're doing all right with that. Would you ever run for office?
Nope.
Nope. All right, hey, real quick, we're gonna stop the recording and take a quick 10-minute break.
Okay. All right. So I'll hang up and wait.
No, hold on.
Stay.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. Oh. technical difficulties.
Push the button.
Okay. All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the second half of the podcast. And we are back with Miguel from the Alpha Male Buddhist Podcast from Brooklyn. And I say that wrong all the time. I apologize. So let me get to where I think we're almost at the end of this. You know, I stopped a little early, didn't I? Okay. Trying to figure out where we're at here. And okay, do you watch pro wrestling?
You know what? I don't really watch much television now, but to answer your question, Randy Macho Man Savage.
Nice.
Stone Cold Steve Austin, right?
Nice. Nice.
I could go back to Haystacks, Calhoun, Barrett Sakuna, Chief J. Strongbow. I could take you back.
You're naming guys. Yeah, I'm saying you're naming guys from like the 60s and 70s now. Holy shit.
Bruno Sammartino.
That's when Shaif was like in his 30s.
Iron Sheik.
Yeah.
Oh. Nice. Nice.
You know, the Bushwhackers and shit.
Oh, yeah.
I love Macho Man Savage. Ooh, yeah.
I keep telling people, there's a new company out called AEW. It's on TNT. You get a chance, check it out, man. It's a really cool new company, if you ever get back into watching that. Anyway.
You guys are real wrestle heads, huh?
Oh, yeah. I was a wrestler.
And
I tell you what, it almost ruined wrestling for me. Being a pro wrestler almost ruined wrestling. No. Wrestling in high school. I tell you, a lot of guys. I don't want to break the boundary there. I don't want to give away secrets. Not anymore. I keep getting in trouble for that.
Right.
Okay, here's one of my favorite parts of the podcast. Here, tell me about your happiest memory.
I can think of one right off the top of my head. It's a moment that's seared into my head I will never forget. And it transcends happiness into, like, just almost being my core. And this is what it was. I was probably 5 years old. And my dad, you know, he passed away when I was 6, so I was 5. And I was trying to whistle. So I was sitting there, and I'm doing, you know, whistle sounds, and it, like, wasn't really coming out. So I found that if I inhaled in, sucked the air in, I made a little whistle sound. So, I was doing it, and I ran to my dad and said, "Dad, I know how to whistle, watch." And he's sitting on the edge of it, I see him in front of me. And I did the whistle, and he goes, no, you gotta whistle out, you gotta blow out. So, I'm like, fuck. So, I went back, and I did it. And I came to him, and I whistled, and here's the moment. He rubbed my head, like the top of my head, he goes, "My little man."
Aww.
Yo, dude, man, like, that survives with me till today.
Damn,
like,
man.
That's one of the very few exchanges that I can remember with him. I don't want to be a downer, but for me, there's a very fine line between beauty and pain and all of that stuff. They exist, they rest upon one another.
Yeah.
You know? Okay. It's like rain is beautiful. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So,
speaking.
Yeah, that's a real memory. That, and, you know, I guess maybe going to Paris, getting married, the birth of my son.
Nice. No. We have another segment called Kevin K's Random Question. Kevin's a part of our staff here. And he wants to know if you think chemtrails are real or they're a hoax.
Real, man. It's aluminum and barium.
Okay. All right. All right, cool. Rob?
So let's say if you were back being a teenager again, would you indulge in these COVID-19 somewhat college parties?
Fuck yeah.
You're
nice.
Like, fuck yeah.
Nice. Nice.
So you'd be the one like posting it and getting it ready?
Yo, man, I'm there. Whatever I can do to go.
Yeah. You gonna pull a hot tub time machine? That's what you wanna do?
Oh, hey, this exactly.
Right. Nice.
All right, Miguel, that's about all we got, man. You got any questions for us?
No, we're good, but here's the thing, man. I gotta bring you on my show.
Okay. Yeah.
Now, I have one episode in the can. You're a podcaster, you get this.
Yeah.
I did originally a review on The Godfather Part 1, and it still is in my top 10 sometimes. So I ended up doing Godfather Part 2. Those movies are freaking phenomenal, and I highly recommend you watch Godfather 1 and 2. But anyway, I did Part 2, but I never put it out. So I need to drop that, and I think I have another one canned up, but let's work it out within the next few weeks. Bring you on the show, freeform, just like this.
Sweet.
One, and then the second thing, I want you to send me a little clip, whether it's 5 minutes or whatever it is. You guys doing, you cats doing your shit. Send me the audio clip, and I'm going to insert it into my next episode, and then we'll plan out, you know, you guys coming on.
Okay.
The one thing with my podcast, I move it like chess pieces on a board.
Okay.
Because I feel the zeitgeist that's going on in the air, and I kind of try to address it through that episode that I'm putting out. So my last few have been kind of serious, you know, as far as shit that's going down and trying to elevate us as people. But absolutely, I want to bring you guys on, talk about what you want to talk about, whatever the hell you guys want to talk about. We'll get into it just like we are now. But send me a little promo so I can put it up on the on my next episode.
Sure, absolutely.
I'm getting good.
You got it, man. You got it.
Sounds like a plan, bro.
You got it, man.
All
right. Hold on to the line. Hold on for a second. We'll stop the recording here in a second. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining in and listening to our episode with Miguel from the Alpha Male Buddhist Podcast from Brooklyn. I said it wrong again. God damn it. And Rob?
What up, everybody, and have a good night.
All right. Thank you again, Miguel. We really appreciate it, brother.
All right, man. We'll talk and send me that clip so I can put it on my next episode.
Oh, you're gonna get the clip, man.
Well,
thank you, guys.
No problem, brother.
What's up, Two Stone Dudes? This is your feature presentation, Jay Garland. Looking forward to all the exciting things you guys have planned for the show. And then, of course, looking forward to being a guest once again as soon as you guys welcome me back. Keep up the good work.
Welcome to the next segment of the Two Stone Dudes Podcast. This is your co-host, Ryan Castle. On the line with me, we got my man, Shafe. My man, Shafe, welcome back to the podcast for the East Coast sort of version of this thing. And we're looking for much for like a report on what's going on with the rioting and looting throughout the country pretty much. And you got some information for us.
Well, I don't know if it's information, but I mean, it's just a scenario of what's going down in Kenosha, Wisconsin, because they had a shooting of an African-American individual by the police. Shady video. The video that I saw was weird. You know, you hear these gunshots, but like you don't see the gunshots. And where the video, where the incident happens at, it's like in the driver's seat of a car with the door open, so it's super close range, and you hear all these shots. Yeah, I mean, you end up hearing like friggin', I don't know, 7 shots, but you don't see any smoke, you don't see any flashes, you don't really even see like either of the cops' hands jerking at all. You know what I mean? Like, you bust off seven shots, there's going to be some movement, you know? And the guys got, they each got one hand on the gun, really. Like, they're not even in, like, whatever, you know, prone position, holding it steady with two hands. So it was a shady video to me, but nonetheless, guy gets shot, you know, and riots spark off, you know, burning and looting spark off. And I don't know what Kenosha, Wisconsin is. I don't know if it's like, I don't know if it's hood. I don't know. You know, I know there's some hoods in Wisconsin, like Milwaukee and stuff like that. But I don't know what kind of area that is. It sounds like some back road. You know what I mean?
Right.
Back country, whatever. But so they get to it. They get to rioting and looting. They get to burning. And I guess it's BLM and Antifa, pretty much, on the streets. And I don't know, this one video, I was just watching some of the raw footage. The one video starts with, I guess they're at a car dealership, and they're smashing windows and just getting ready to just blaze the whole thing, cars included. And somebody steps up, you know, somebody steps to the scene with an AR. It's actually a young kid. Yeah, it ends up being a young white kid, 17-year-old white kid, 17 years old, dude.
Wow, what the fuck?
Is out. Yeah, I mean, this shit
How's
is just
firepower, man. Shit.
I mean, he's probably got well. It's like he can get it. I mean, the family probably has guns. You know what I'm saying? So apparently, he's a member of this movement. Have you heard of this movement, Boogaloo Boys?
Yes and no. Like, I've seen it on Instagram, but I don't think it's related to that. But that's about the most I've heard of it.
I don't know a lot about it either. Apparently, I don't know. I don't know. I hear right wing and, like, white guys that's I don't know, ready to fight back against BLM or something like that. I really don't know a lot about it, but I keep seeing them reference Boogaloo Boys. Which is actually a really cool name, but I don't know anything about their movement, but apparently he's part of them. So 17-year-old white kid shows up. He wants to defend the car, car lot or whatever. Both sides were armed. He was there with a big old AR. I mean, you know, it's like the gun is like three quarters of the size of him. You know what I'm saying?
Right, there's some attachments here.
Or at least half the size of him. I mean, this kid, he's just got this massive gun. And the other side is, you know, BLM Antifa. There's guys with guns, too. So one guy had a revolver. I didn't see any big guns on that side, but they were armed, too. And they get to shooting, bro.
Now, you think this is a legit video?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, 100%. I mean, this is a raw video.
It's not something that was planned.
No.
Okay.
Why would you ask that?
Because
I could see that being the police video more so than the video I just watched.
Right. A lot of things seem fishy to me nowadays. You know what I mean? I believe half of what I see and none of what I hear for the most part.
To me, you should be able to discern.
I have to look at the video, right? I have to look at the video.
Yeah, I mean, this is raw video, raw up close cell phone video.
Okay.
So the angle in the car videos to me, and the sound sometimes didn't match up with the video. That's why I thought that was fishy. This is all matched up. It's just raw. It's raw video, and I mean, what the point I'm trying to make is a guy gets popped, guy gets shot in the head.
Damn.
Yeah, and you see. I mean, you see it. So anyway, so they're at the car dealership. Shots are exchanged. One dude gets shot in the head. They got footage of him on the ground. See, the thing about it is, bro, is you have just they're not journalists, but you have citizens with cameras everywhere. Like it's at a time like it's never been before. Where, I mean. It's insane to me. It just blows my mind to even talk about it, think about it. But it's like there's at least 20 people around each scenario and each incident, but everybody has a phone out and is recording. Everybody.
Right. Like, we don't have to worry about Big Brother so much. We have to worry about each other now.
Well, it's No, it's just that we're seeing some of the sickest things that we've ever seen.
Yeah, like,
and
why
seeing...
people show that shit, man? Fuck.
Well, it's not. It makes its way out there, bro. It's important stuff. It's a huge deal. Right. You know, the guy got popped in the head. So they show, and they get a close-up of the guy on the ground. He don't even look like he's bleeding out the head. It looks like it's internal. It's insane.
Wow.
But so they're trying to revive him, trying to resuscitate him. That guy dies, apparently. Now, after this incident, the white kid with the AR, boogaloo boy, he boogaloos out of there. And he starts running. He starts running away from the scene. Again, crazy footage because you see this kid running with this massive gun. So he gets followed by the mob, by a mob of people. So, you know, the other side, BLM Antifa, they start chasing him because they're like, yo, dude just shot somebody in the head, you know. But this mob that's chasing him is very bizarre. They, like, don't know what to do. It seems to them like almost live action role playing. It seems like they're playing out something that is made up in their head that they've seen before on TV or social media, because they're chasing this kid with this huge gun, and like apparently they did have one gun out there, but nobody's like brandishing anything. I mean, they're just chasing a guy with a huge gun. It doesn't make any sense.
Right.
So one kid up to the kid with the AR and swings on him, and, like, from behind. And I'm just like, what is this dude doing? He swings on him, like, misses, and then runs away because he was actually the smaller one. The rest of the mob continues to chase this dude. I'm like, why are they chasing this dude? This is going to be bad. And the kid ends up falling. Kid with the AR ends up falling down. Now the mob comes to jump on him. And, you know, he gets to pop. Now, why I don't think that this video is staged, first of all, definitely not staged, because there's people all over the place. You wouldn't be able to stage something like that. But you hear the pops, you see the flashes, and you see the smoke when he lets that gun off. He's on the ground. And guys, one dude comes up and hits him with a skateboard. Again, craziest shit you ever seen, bro. A kid with a huge AR with people running up to him, like, hitting him with a skateboard. It's just like, are you insane? You're going to get, well, and what happens is that guy gets his arm blown off. The dude lets off, kills one dude. It's crazy video. The other guy that hit him with the skateboard is, like, standing there right in front of him. I'm like, oh my God, he lets off, boom, blows a chunk out of this dude's forearm up to the elbow like you have never seen, bro. Wow. I mean, or maybe you have, unfortunately, but what I'm saying is, blows this dude's arm off. Dude's probably going to have to get it amputated.
Right.
And, you know, then they backed off after that, you know. So he killed one, that the car lot shot him in the head when it's... fire was exchanged, so I guess they were shooting back, or I don't know exactly what happened. They chase the guy, he falls, they go to try to, I don't know what they're trying to do, the craziest thing I ever seen. He lets off, kills another guy, and blows another dude's arm off.
There's a lot of things about that video I got to say now. There's a lot of things, like, number one, how traumatizing does that video have to be to anybody who sees that? I think that's been marginalized hugely.
Bro, that is exactly what I was trying to say, and I wasn't getting my point across well enough about everybody having a camera, is that there's a new level of trauma that we're entering into and we've entered into, where you have this, and let me go deeper than that, because there's different Instagrams I follow where it's just, there's so many cameras between everybody with the cameras and everybody with the ring cameras, like in their door and in their window.
Right.
That all the footage from all these inner cities comes out, bro. There's sites where you can go and it'll just be posts every day of the violence that goes on. And I mean, you've never seen shit like this, bro. Like, back in the day, we had Faces of Death. Remember Faces
yeah,
of
yeah,
Death?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, where that's where you saw.
And that was fucked up enough.
Yeah, it was crazy. And you know, you saw live people, you know, live murders and crazy shit like that happening. But what the point I'm trying to make is that it's take that and multiply it by 20 million is to what you're seeing now, where you're just seeing this high definition footage of people just blowing each other's heads off, stabbing each other, just insane shit.
So how desensitized have we become as a society to where that's become normal?
I mean, it's
not normal shit.
No, it's definitely not normal. And, you know, in the inner cities, they are normalized to it, and it's insane. You know, it's crazy, and those kids are, and it's just, we're at a state of mass, you know, full mass infiltration, because you've seen so much violence. Not that now it's evolved. Like, you used to see it in the movies, and we would say, you know, are these movies bad? And not should they be censored, but should people be responsible for the violence they put in movies and video games and stuff like that? To now, you could just open up your phone and literally watch an hour of people's heads getting blown off a day. Like, not archive shit. Like, live, like, every day. It's insane, bro. And these kids got these guns like you never seen. I saw this one video. It was either from Atlanta or Chicago. Two young black kids having an argument. Both got guns in their hands. One has this mini machine gun with a banana clip. It's just mind-blowing to look at on video. The other kid has a big old handgun. They're arguing back. There was a woman there. The kid with the handgun follows the kid with the mini machine gun. The kid with the handgun puts his gun down on the ground and says, squares up and says, you know, let's do it like this. You know, 10 seconds later, dude, the mini machine gun guy is just pumping like 5 bullets into him, and you just see the kid collapse. I mean, that you can see that on Instagram right now.
Wow. Unbelievable.
You know, so it's just, you know, we're in a really messed up time.
Right. Right.
And I don't know who, you know, else is thinking that. Or
I bet it's in everybody's mind.
Is it though, bro?
It should be.
Because if it was on everybody's mind, wouldn't people be more up in arms and doing something about it?
Well, we had a guy on the podcast, the interview before the show, talk about the demoralization of the country. All right, the demoralization of the country. Okay,
mm-hmm.
And what he had on his podcast was a former KGB agent who explained how Soviet Russia became about.
Yeah, Yuri Bresmanov.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm familiar.
And this is a stage of it.
Yeah, ideological subversion.
Right, right. And try explaining that to a normal person. You know, like, this is conditioning, and people don't understand. This is conditioning to the violence that is going to, this is going to get worse before it gets better.
Yeah, I mean, you know, bro, I definitely agree with that. And as we said on the last time I spoke to you, is that you know, it's like the thing I want the least is what it just seems like it's dead set on happening the most, you know, and that's bloodshed and violence. And it's just dumb. It's just, you know, it's unnecessary. You should be aiming your focus at the people in charge, not fighting each other on the street, because that's what the people in charge want, is us fighting each other on the street.
I think it's up to people. It could be, you know what, this is just my take on it, Shaif. I think it's up to people like you, like myself, and like other like-minded people, especially people that listen to this podcast. Maybe it's time for us to step up and go, you know what, this is wrong. This is not the way things are supposed to be. This is not right.
I agree. you know, but we do. It's not like, you know, we do. Me and you have now spoke about it. Me and you are doing hours of content on it. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
It's just, you know, and it goes back to what the Russian guy says, is like, when that level of demoralization and subversion sets in, what he says is you could lay out any amount, you could show someone, you know, paperwork stamped right in their face with proof of whatever you're talking about, and they still won't accept it. You know, because psychologically, it's just they're controlled fully, but turned off. You know, right. Part of them is turned off, and the truest fact of anything, they can see it happen right in front of their eyes. They won't believe because of how affected they are mentally. I don't know, bro. It's crazy, man. It's sad, and I just don't, you know, friggin' see an end, bro. I don't see an end. You know,
I still have hope that somebody can step up and do something about it. I still have hope that that can happen.
I see that you probably do still have more hope. I think that out there for you guys, maybe you were locked down less. Is that true? How was it out there?
It's not even a thing, really.
Right. And you guys out there have open carry just all over, correct?
Correct.
Yeah, so, I mean, that's a whole different ballgame.
There's less violence in Arizona because of the open carry law.
Right. And that's what, yeah, that's what the Second Amendment people's, you know, main argument is that all the places with guns are much safer.
Dude, like, our riots happened in Scottsdale, which is the whitest part of Arizona. And it happened for, like, a whole 13 hours, I think.
It's too hot out, bro.
Bro, seriously. You know, that's what I attribute it to. If it was cooler out, there might have been some shit going on, but it's too hot out.
Yeah. I once in a while Google Phoenix, and it just, the numbers on there are just like, you know, I just go back to, I can't even believe the numbers. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like 110 at like 9 a.m. It's just like, oh my God.
Yeah, people would probably like to riot. They're just, it's too busy staying inside and chilling their air conditioning.
Yeah, you get tired in that type of heat.
But let's get back to this.
I forgot what I was saying. But yeah, so what I'm saying is that when you have that type of environment, there's going to be way less harassment. You know, people, whether there's less violence or not, I'm sure there is, there's going to be way less harassment and way more mind your own business.
Right. Seriously.
You know, seriously. Out here, it's not mind your own business. It's everybody now in each other's business. Everybody judging each other on, you know, who's the most virtuous and who's, you know, it's like they got these masks on. You never see a bro covering up, you know, the whole face to the ears and over the nose. And, like, you can barely see the eyes. And they put sunglasses on and they're out walking their dog and they're gentrifiers in a black neighborhood. It's just like these people are out of their mind, you know. They're their own special type of ill, you know, but it's a lot of, you know, but it's a lot of harassment, you know, it's hurt, man. Society is hurt.
Well, that's the next thing we have to get to, is where does the healing begin?
I don't know, bro. I hope that, this is what I said. And I hate to say this, and I hate saying these things because currently, I won't say I've been on a hot streak, but I've been right about a lot of stuff that was going on, especially with the people I talked to, just on events, you know, and I don't know, I almost think that there has to be a big, like a mass death to shake the people, something where everybody will finally just say enough is enough, or we're headed for a civil war, bro.
Yeah.
You know, because people are having to take up arms to defend businesses and defend, you saw the people here in Philly were down defending the Columbus statue, and also there was just a group of people that were out defending the Target in their neighborhood when the stuff was going on in Philly, you know, just a group of neighborhood people. So that's not what I want to see, bro. I, you know, like we said before on the pods, you know, I don't want to see any more bloodshed, man. It's enough. It doesn't have to be like this. But anyway, so the point I'm trying to make is I don't see people being jolted out of their hypnotic doldrum without some type of major event.
I think you're right. Unfortunately, I think you're right, and that may be the next step. That may be the next phase in all this.
I mean, it's like if Trump wins or if Biden wins, I just don't see... I don't know, man.
Doug, Doug Stanhope said it best. What if I don't want a leader?
If you what?
What if I don't want a leader? What if having a leader is a good chunk of the cause of all this?
Right. See, but that's what they say. That's what the anarchists say. That's what the little postmodernists and Marxists say, because it's a little deception. You understand what I'm saying? So he says it as, what if we don't want a leader? That, you know, as it's a good thing. But no, what he really means is, well, everything can come down. Everything can crash and burn. You know. No more president, no more this, no more that. There's a system in place that works, bro. We're here. We're all alive on this, you know, giant ball spinning through space. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
There's infrastructure everywhere. There's opportunity everywhere. We just have to open our eyes and see it and go get it and stop worrying about trivial things like what race someone is or what ethnicity someone is or what this or what that. No one cares. Real people don't care. Real people don't care about your race, gender, nothing. They just want to have a job that pays, that they can save, that they can have a retirement. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
At this point in 2020, those issues are put to bed, man. No real person is caring about that. It's being drummed up more so by the fringes of each side, and it's you know, it's hurting the mass populace. You know what I mean?
Right. You know, dude, I wouldn't mind just going to work every day, not having to worry about bullshit, paying my fucking bills, and calling it a fucking day. I mean, what the fuck is wrong with that? Not such a bad lifestyle.
Right, but then right now, bro, that puts you on the right. Like, if that's what you're talking about right now, you're a Trump supporter.
Hmm.
Because that's what the right is offering. You know, the right has been thrust into this place of where, you know, if they're just not as horrible as the other side, they'll look even better, because the other side has gone so far off the cliff.
Right.
You know, so it's like they just woke up where they could capitalize on this populist thing. It might be it's so much so that it might be the plan. I think that maybe the left is doing all this on purpose to push people to the right, because they have the right control too. And then when the right takes control, they'll fuck it up in their right leaning way, and it'll be crazy that way. Because I see him making these moves that. It seems like they want to lose. It seems like Biden and Harris to me is just a dead loser. There's nothing that excites me about either of those people. They're both swamp creatures.
They call them swamp creatures.
Kamala Harris, she's terrible, bro.
Dude, she's put more people in prison for marijuana than anybody I've heard of.
I mean, it's just bizarre, bro. It's like
right.
They want them to lose.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, I totally get it.
And then Biden comes out. Everything Biden talks about is super divisive. He comes out and says, if I was in, it'd be 3 months mandated masks. Even the people that support masks don't support that. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
It seems like they want...
Yeah, somebody's writing some failure shit for him. I can honestly tell you that.
Oh, he's a nightmare, bro. It's rough, man. Those dead black eyes and just stammering and stumbling and, you know, trying to talk each other together. It's just the most, it's craziest. You could just go on YouTube.
It's as if they took the worst candidate they possibly could.
That's what I'm trying to say.
Like, Bernie, I liked Bernie. I liked I'm a Yang Gang kind of guy. And those guys, all those guys would have been a better choice.
I mean, I don't like either of those people. You know, I don't really like a lot of anybody. I think Trump pre-COVID sufficient. You know, he gave you jobs and he gave you some wage growth. And you can't really ask for more than that. You know what I mean? He should have made a move on college debt and kind of to help the young people more so. And he didn't. I think that hurt him. But overall, no one can argue with the first 3 years of what Trump was doing.
If he wasn't such an asshole, I don't think people would.
I know, but what makes him an asshole is my question.
Just his views and ways he says things, I guess. I don't know.
I mean, he's a ball breaker.
Right. And he does, that's not what a president's supposed to be, though.
I know. Who says who? You understand what I'm saying? My thing is like, yo, yes, he does say some crazy shit, a lot of crazy shit. He does say some dumb shit. That lets me know he's real. You know what I'm saying? Because he'll say shit that, you know, he'll speak his mind. You know what I'm saying? And sometimes when you're a person that speaks your mind, you say crazy shit. You say dumb shit, and you're a ball breaker too. I mean, you know, you'll come out with some outlandish things, or things will come out. But no one speaks like these other politicians speak, you know, so perfectly with tone and inflection and just, you know what I mean, drawing you into the, it's fake, bro. You know what I'm saying? I like him because of the dumb shit he says, because I know that makes me know he's real. He's speaking off the cuff from his heart.
Okay.
You know? I just don't see what was wrong with what he was doing. You know, I really don't. I don't see where this, where we were in some existential crisis, like I just heard on Rogan.
All right, well, talk about the kids in cages thing with me then.
The kid in cages?
Yeah.
I mean, that was happening under Obama as well.
I don't know. I didn't hear about it till after he got elected, and like I saw it happen around here. You know, I saw people getting rounded up and. Who were illegal immigrants and being separated from their families. Like, we saw that shit on the news. And we saw that shit in person. And that's what disturbed me about the guy. Like, I could give a fuck about what he said, but when I saw that, you know, you can't do that. You know? And if that was before his time, then I didn't know about that.
Yeah, I mean, listen, I'm not going to support that necessarily. You know what I'm saying? But I also think that, you know, I don't know, unless you're telling me that was his hardline policy that had him doing that, you know? I don't know. I think the border was at crisis level.
Right.
And I think that we needed strong control at the border. And with COVID rearing its ugly head, I mean, even though I think it's mostly a hoax, I mean, you don't want an open border, bro. You don't want people pouring across the border.
Right.
You know? Right. It's just an unfortunate... you know, instance. It's just an unfortunate thing both ways. I don't want to see people getting rounded up. I don't want to see people getting separated. But I also don't want to see tons and tons of people coming over illegally and taking jobs from Americans and things like that. And then they get into, oh, they don't take jobs. No, yes, they do. I mean, I'm in the city. I'm in the, not the inner city, but I'm in a part where you see the crews. You see the construction crews. And, you know, it's a black community, but they're not black construction crews. So I'll put it that way. So, you know, it's tough. It's nuanced policy stuff. It's you know, you got to really dig down and understand that there's two sides to that fence, and you got to look each way. Right now, I think we need to lean on the stronger side because we've leaned on the lax side for too long.
Okay. Shoot, I don't know where else to go with that. About this, I'm still on this video. I'm still fucked up about this video, Sean.
Really what, the video where they shot the people?
Yeah, like, I...
Yeah, chilling just video.
The amount of violence that's being shown in videos, it's just... It's staggering, dude, and it's disturbing. Especially to somebody like me, especially to other vets in the country. It's like, we didn't come home to see shit like that. You know what I'm saying? Vets came home... to basically the same shit they just left. So, I imagine that a lot of them are desensitized to this shit.
Listen, I want to say right now that I stand with every veteran who gave time, service, his physical self, his mental self, or her physical and mental self. God bless every one of them, bro, because those are people that are out there paying the ultimate sacrifice for any freedom to be left anywhere. And to come home and have to see freedom being stole away, sucked away, shot, and beat away has got to be re-traumatizing to a lot of men and women that have already been traumatized by things that they really shouldn't have to been traumatized by in the first place.
Right.
You know, so shout to them, man, and you too, and thank you to you and to them, because these are important people that no one thinks about and that really get demonized. You know what I'm saying? Especially now, coming up in the environment we're in with defund the police and anti-police and all this. I mean, you know, the vets are in there too, man. And it's just like, man, people need to open up their perspective and understand that there's more going on than what they're seeing on their Facebook feed.
Right, right. Thank you for saying that. It's,
you know,
I don't know where this world's going to go, but I tell you what, I'd like to be a voice. I think you would too.
I would love to, but let me ask you this: like, what could the vets do? What do you think? Where do you think their place is in what's going on, and how they can be a part of the solution?
In government.
In government.
Yes.
I agree with that.
Yes, and I'll tell you why. If you want a stronger America, that's what you do. You put somebody, like, people think I'm joking when I say put Jesse Ventura and General Mattis in charge and this whole thing will get fixed really fucking quick. It's because both of those men know what trauma is, they know what struggle is, they know what it is to lead people. You know? They definitely know what it is. And Jesse Ventura, from what I understand, did a damn good job as the governor of Minnesota. And he believes in the bullshit behind the curtain. Like, he knows what the fuck is going on. And Mattis was a man who showed no fear of anything, you know. And he said funny, and he has a witty ass personality too. And it's a shame that he got, like, I don't know whether he resigned or whether he was fired by the Trump administration, but I believe it was a big mistake. Because I believe that's a man of
great. I think he stepped away.
Well,
I
believe
think he stepped
that,
down.
That might be a mistake on his part, because we need somebody like him right now.
Yeah, I don't trust him whatsoever, but I trust what you're saying completely, and I trust that we need some guys. You know who's the guy? How about Dan Crenshaw? You ever hear of that guy?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, dude like him, man. I mean, you know, listen, I'm all for it, and I would like to see that. I think we need a lot of change in, I think we need radical change in what's the politicians, all of them, man. I mean, we need people that's really, like you said, you know, that's leaders and just that can inject some common sense back into what the heck's going on, because I just feel like it's not a lot of common sense being used,
no,
especially
not. You're absolutely right.
In policy making and everything, and it's that's what needs to be used the most. So yeah, man, let's see it, man. Let's see the vets, you know, rally and get in there. I don't know. I think a lot of them are probably right leaners. But, you know...
No, that's not true. That's not true at all, trust me.
Well, talk to me about that. Talk to me about the left-wingers, because the left is clearly anti-gun, and wouldn't veterans be very pro-gun?
No. Yeah, listen, man. A lot of the vets that I talk to, the guys I still talk to from the Marine Corps, are basically like, their basic mindset is like, this is a bunch of bullshit, it needs to fucking end, somebody needs to do something bad so I can go back to fucking work and feed my goddamn family. That's the basic mindset of people.
That's conservative. That's the conservative mindset.
You know, they just want things to fucking get fixed and call it a fucking day. Because a lot of guys, okay, we're looking at things from an older point of perspective, and I can't speak for all of them. I can just say for the ones that I talk to, they're just, you know, they're fed up, and they want something to be done, and you know, a lot of them look to the president as a leader because that's what we were taught. On the other hand, I look the other direction. But I'm middle as far as I'm concerned, and I'm middle compared to most of my guys that I was in with. So it's like we all have a certain perspective, but then we all have different perspectives as well. So that's how.
And then so you look to the president as a leader, and you don't feel as though he's a good leader.
Me personally, no. Other guys, yes.
Okay, and why don't you?
I just don't like how he conducts himself. I know as a, it's not how a leader should conduct himself.
So personality, you're saying?
Exactly. That's the biggest turnoff for me.
Right, but bro, don't you... I mean, to me, that should be the absolute last thing that you use to judge a politician.
Well, not when the rest of the world looks at us the way that we're all being like him. That's how most of the rest of the world feels bad for us right now.
That's ridiculous. That's one of the most ridiculous thing I've... what are you talking about? Who?
Foreigners. Like, people that not from this country. Like, the ones that I've talked to, they don't like the guy. Not a lot of people do. And they have a perspective that they feel bad for us that's our leader. Because
that's ridiculous, bro.
The way he's handled himself internationally.
Yes, what do you mean with total strength?
Strength but no compassion.
I don't see where...
There has to be a balance, Schaefer.
Right, bro, but where is there no compassion is what I'm saying.
Jeez, I've been building up. Now I don't have anything to say about it. Damn.
Yeah, because it's I don't think it's there's no merit to it, bro. You know what I mean? It's not true. It's just not true. And this is what I
look. I can sit here and look a couple things up, but you know who I'm influenced by.
Yeah, I mean, and that's fine. And whether it's true or not, it's fine either way. But I'm just saying that I just think that it's the narrative. But I think it's the way he's shown. I think internationally he's been extremely strong. I think he's tried to get troops out of Iraq. He just did the Iraq and Afghanistan. He just did the peace deal with the UAE.
See, it's a shame that you don't hear about those things. You don't hear about those things a lot of times. The good things he does, I don't hear about. The only time I hear about it is from you. You know, you give me a better perspective on the guy now.
Yeah, I mean, he's been strong. Nothing people can. To me, everything they say about him is a lie, and it's not. And I don't even like him that much. Like, as far as policy wise, I'm not like totally in line with him on policy. But I just see that outright vitriol, and I see that even the center people won't give him any credit for anything. So that's what makes me very suspicious, is like people in the center, people that are moderate, just still have the same narrative on him that he's inept and he hasn't done anything. And it's just crazy. You know what I mean? That's not true. You know, if you're a true progressive, and I have liberal progressive friends, definitely a guy that's like a brother to me considers himself a progressive liberal. He's a very successful lawyer, and we talk politically, and we're obviously like very opposite on a lot of things. And it's just like, you know, he's a fraud. If you consider yourself a progressive liberal, you have to love Trump for the First Step Act. Period. If you don't love the First Step Act or strongly like and commend the president for the First Step Act, which is prison reform, you're a fraud leftist. You're a fraud liberal. You're a fraud progressive. It's the issue where I could put it out and I can know who you are politically by how you address it. Because
Talk about it.
Prison reform was like... it's called the First Step Act. So he was eliminating some of the cash bail. He was letting people out of jail that were in there for nonviolent drug offenses. What else was the first? Doing away with some of the mandatory minimums and changing the discrepancy in coke powder and hard cocaine, you know. So like before, you would get less time for powder cocaine, and if you had crack, you would get way more time, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
So, you know, disproportionately affecting the African-American communities. I mean, he did that. Really, Kushner did it, and, you know, Kushner and Ivanka are leftists, you know. So, really, I mean, it's crazy. There's a balance in there with Trump, Trump is basically just a deal maker, and he'll just he made that deal with Kushner because it was what he thought was a good that, you know, the left has been wanting for a long time. It could never get passed, and he'll do any other deal with any other. You know, he's at his heart a liberal, is now more conservative. Then you have Melania, who is very conservative. So So she's pulling him that way. Then you have Jared and Ivanka, who are both like New York City liberal leftists. So you have a dynamic in there where really you can get the best of all worlds. And you've seen it a lot. You've seen it in the policy. He's been conservative on some things. He's been tough on China and all that. But then he'll go to the left and do prison reform. And if you're a leftist, if you support Democrats and consider yourself, especially these progressive leftists who are like progressive liberals, they call themselves, you have to like the First Step Act. And Trump, you have to give him props for it. You have to. If you don't, you're a complete fraud and you cannot be trusted politically, nor should your views be taken seriously in any way, shape, or form. You know? You know, he's covered the span of topics to where you can't just bash him outright. And all I hear is outright bashing constantly.
Right.
I never hear anybody in the middle say it's always, I don't let you know. It's wrong to me. And I don't even line up with all that stuff.
Shafe, what are the libertarians saying about this?
Libertarians are Trump leaners for sure.
Okay. Because that's where I fall in line. So now... Now that makes more sense.
Yeah, libertarians are really, at this point in the game, just conservatives. But, you know, that's more pro-drug and pro-gay type stuff, you know, LGBT, you know? Because the libertarians will look at it like, you know, there shouldn't be. But they just want the government out of their lives. The same thing you were talking about with all your homies and my homies and you and me. You just want the government out of your life. Leave us alone. You're already sucking us dry with your taxes, and now you've added your vicious tyranny on top of it. Just stop. Stop doing it.
Have you ever heard the joke about the libertarians' policy?
No, what is it?
We want to take over your government and leave you alone?
Yeah, I mean...
That's the policy, pretty much.
I mean, their candidate is not a serious person.
Oh, Joe Jorgensen? No, she's not.
You know, and the guy, Gary Johnson, I mean, you know,
that guy was a trip, dude. He made a joke on national TV, and it was funny as fuck, and nobody liked it. I thought it was funny.
I mean, listen, he was high on edibles, and, you know, that happens.
Yeah.
I don't know, I just think I would have performed better even if I was on edibles.
Oh, yeah, dude. I can't say any different, bro. Because I've been stuck at the house on edibles, so I give the guy credit for even going on TV.
Now, listen, I'll tell you a quick story. So in the summers, I work at down at this place, the Dell in Philadelphia. It's in the hood. It's an outdoor concert venue. Well, one year they had Barack Obama came to speak, and I almost got the whole event shut down because I was eating edibles. And I don't know, for some reason, I didn't really think they were working like that.
You ate more, didn't you?
So I just kept downing them, and then next thing you know, I'm in the spot booth where we have the spotlights with, like, this window thing cracked open, and Secret Service is, like, running up there because I'm sitting there, God. I don't know, yeah, like, reading a book or something like that, and just totally out of it. I had this window cracked, and it was, like, right near, it was, like, dead in front of the stage. It was a nightmare. So, edibles can be a little, you know, iffy.
That's fucking funny, bro.
Yeah, it was crazy.
Well, I think we had a good session. And I think all that needed to be said was said. So let's end the recording. We'll talk afterwards.
Yes, brother.
All right. Thank you for coming on, Shafe. I appreciate it, brother. Thanks for the segment.
Love you, man.
Love you too, man. All right, ladies and gentlemen, that was all for the Two Stone Dudes podcast. I hope you enjoyed. Look for us on social media and check out our new Twitter account, our Two Stone Dudes podcast. And I want to say what's up to everybody on the staff, Nick, Danny, Shafe, Rob, we got so many people now, Kevin. Those guys did a great job contributing content, and I really appreciate it, guys. Listen to our next episode coming up. It should be released before the end of the weekend. Thank you very much for sticking with me this long, and enjoy the rest of the week.